Great. Thank you so much. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for coming and welcome. My name is Tom Boyke. I'm the director of the Global Health Program at the Council on Foreign Relations. And it is my great pleasure to welcome you to this roundtable entitled The Expanding Monkeypox Outbreak. For the first time since the COVID-19 pandemic began, the World Health Organization convened an emergency committee to decide whether a different disease, monkeypox, now also constitutes a public health emergency of international concern. While the WHO Director General did not make that declaration last week, and the emergency committee did not recommend that he do so, the committee did advise that the Director General should reconvene them quickly based on the evolving situation, which Dr. Tedros, the Director General, yesterday said he intends to do. Since early May 22, 2022, cases of monkeypox, a disease which is ordinarily endemic to West and Central Africa, has been identified in more than 50 countries where the disease is not normally found. As of yesterday, the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention counts more than 5,100 cases globally. But that is no doubt a significant underestimate, as testing has been limited in some of those countries. And that is most particularly true in the United States. The United States right now is a black box of monkeypox. It has currently confirmed 550 monkeypox cases in the last 10 weeks, but rollout of testing has been limited to public health laboratories, and that rollout has been slow, that we have really no idea what the true number is. This has led some critics to say the United States government is making the very same errors that were made in the early days of the COVID-19 pandemic. The White House released this week a plan to expand testing and vaccination using a vaccine that had been developed for smallpox, or two vaccines that have been developed for smallpox. But the critics have said that that plan is far too little and too late, and says too little about what the U.S. will do to contribute to addressing global needs. In today's roundtable, we're going to examine what we know about the expanding monkeypox outbreak globally and in the United States. We're going to examine the emerging responses to that threat and the risks of inadequate action against this outbreak. To help us make sense of those topics, we are enormously fortunate to have two truly superb speakers today. Both are well accomplished and have the lengthy biographies to match. In the interest of time, I'm going to grossly truncate their biographies down to largely their titles. I urge you to look at the longer versions in your meeting packet shared in the Zoom chat. I will introduce them in the order that they're speaking. Anne Rimoin is considered by many to be one of the world's foremost experts on monkeypox. She is a professor of epidemiology and the Gordon-Levin Endowed Chair in Infectious Diseases and Public Health at UCLA Fielding School of Public Health. Lou Borio needs no introduction to his CFR audience, as she is, of course, one of CFR's senior fellows for global health, and we're very proud that that is the case. She is also a venture partner at the venture capital firm Arch, formerly from the National Security Council and chief scientist at the US FDA, and is truly expert on global health security and countermeasures. Anne is going to start us off with 7 to 10 minutes summarizing where we are in this outbreak, what we know about this virus, how this outbreak started and has spread, where cases are rising, and the risks if we don't get this outbreak under control. Lou will spend a similar amount of time providing an overview of the state of play on monkeypox vaccines, therapeutics, and diagnostics, what we know about their effectiveness and limitations, and current global supplies and administration plans. After that, I will draw them both into a conversation. After that conversation, we'll try to leave 20 or 30 minutes for questions from the audience. One last caution before we get started, today's session is on the record. And with that, I will turn it to Anne to start us off.
Well, thank you for including me. This is the first time that I've been invited to this really amazing group of people to be able to speak to. So thank you so much for having me. I, as you said, I've been working on monkeypox for a lengthy period of time, and I'll just give you a quick background just so that you understand my context. I'm an infectious disease epidemiologist, as you said. I've been working in the Democratic Republic of Congo since 2002, so for two decades. My work actually started in DRC on monkeypox and working on the epidemiology of monkeypox, so it's something that I've been spending a significant amount of time on. My research team has been funded on and off to be working on monkeypox. Monkeypox funding has been not as easy to obtain for many years, just because monkeypox was not on the radar as something that was extremely important we've always had to make sacrifices since emerging infections have not been number one on the priority list. So I have currently a research project ongoing in DRC where we're providing technical assistance to the Congolese government to be able to do biosurveillance and to improve capacity for disease surveillance for monkeypox right now as well. So that just gives you a little bit of context from where I am coming from in this discussion. So to give you a little bit of background, so to go through the list of things that Thomas has given me to be able to discuss today, I'll just start. The points are of course where we are with the outbreak. Maybe we'll bring that a little bit further along, but start with what we know about monkeypox and how we've gotten to where we are. Just to give you some background here, monkeypox is a zoonotic virus that is a pox virus. So it's a cousin of smallpox. It was first discovered in monkeys in 1958 in a colony, and that's why it is called monkeypox. Monkeypox is actually a misnomer. It's monkeys are incidental hosts. Primates in general are incidental hosts, both non-human and human primates. But we believe that the virus, that the true reservoir are rodents, and in particular in places where it is endemic, in a variety of species of squirrels and other rodents as well. The first time that monkeypox was discovered in humans was in 1970 in the Democratic Republic of Congo, which is of course where I work, in a child that was 9 months old, unvaccinated, and this was in the context of the end of the eradication of smallpox. So every case of rash illness that resembled smallpox was being investigated in the context of the eradication program, and samples collected and analyses to be able to ascertain whether or not this was smallpox. So this was a case of monkeypox. First time it was discovered in humans, and that triggered a much larger search for cases of monkeypox. In the 70s, during this time period, there were very few cases of monkeypox discovered, and this was because we had a largely very robust program of smallpox eradication where mass vaccination had occurred and really provided protective immunity against smallpox, monkeypox, and likely other orthopox viruses that are out there. In the 1970s, there were only a few cases, maybe 40 some odd cases that were discovered in several countries. There were a few in West Africa, mostly in DRC, and most were in children that were under the age of 10, unvaccinated. There were a few cases of human-to-human transmission observed, but they were very rare and all in unvaccinated individuals. part of the complication of being able to diagnose monkeypox is that it looks very, very similar to smallpox. And therefore, monkeypox was probably circulating in this population for a long period of time, but it just was undetected and was held at bay because we had circulating smallpox and also because of smallpox vaccination. When smallpox was eradicated from the planet in 1980, vaccination largely stopped globally. And in fact, in DRC, it stopped in 1982 in its entirety. Most of what we understand about monkeypox is from the 1980s. It's from this, there was a period of time from 81 to 86 that WHO had a large research program, intensified disease surveillance, where they looked for every single case of rash illness in places where we know monkeypox had been discovered. And really most of the epidemiology of monkeypox comes from this time period, from 81 to 86. But if you think about that and when vaccination actually ceased, really most of our information is from children who were unvaccinated. So a lot of what we understand in terms of the deep epidemiology of this is from a very different context. It's from the DRC in the 80s, in hunting villages, very rural, very remote. And therefore, we are hampered in terms of our knowledge. There was a large outbreak of monkeypox in 1997 in DRC that was investigated, and there was a realization that there could be co-infection with chickenpox or confusion with chickenpox. But that also occurred right at the moment that the civil war occurred in DRC. And in fact, researchers who were there doing the investigation had to evacuate. And so very little had been done. I arrived in DRC in 2002. There was a lot of discussion about increasing cases in monkeypox. And so I mounted a study in DRC to be able to truly understand what was going on. And what we found over doing disease surveillance, intensified disease surveillance with funding from the National Institutes of Health, was that there was, in fact, a very large rise in the incidence of monkeypox since the eradication of smallpox. And when the modeling was done, it really did seem to be much more than what we anticipated. So the question was, what's going on here? It's important to recognize that there was comparing our data from the 1980 from 2005 to 2007 to the 1980s, you know, we had a very small targeted study that did not have the kind of funding that existed with a large WHO program with large infrastructure. And in fact, the infrastructure that existed even just to support logistics in DRC had decreased significantly since the 1980s. So, you know, we had a very small study. There were small studies then by USAMRID and by CDC, also hampered with small funding and difficult logistics. And so that's really where the bulk of our information comes from. In 2017, there was an outbreak in Nigeria that really signaled something new going on with this virus in Africa. This was part of the West African clade. This was also associated, I guess I should just jump back to 2003. There was an outbreak in the United States that was from imported Gambian rats that then in a holding facility transmitted to prairie dogs. And those prairie dogs ultimately went on to infect owners. There were 47 known cases, suspected and confirmed cases there. It did not increase in scope. Then we had this outbreak in 2017. In 2017, you know, I think as we really start to understand this, we saw the West African clade really starting to expand in its ability to infect. And then between 2017 and 2022, we started to see importations of cases of monkeypox. We had 9 importations during that time period that we were aware of globally. And those cases really didn't go much further. There were a couple cases of transmission in household, but really didn't go very far. Which then brings us to today. We have this outbreak ongoing today. Where are we today? Well, we saw all of a sudden a number of cases being reported globally, all tied to, it seemed at the beginning, either some direct importations or some festivals that occurred in Europe. One festival in Antwerp, one festival in the Canary Islands that had very large numbers of people attending. One was and both having a lot of men attending, men who have sex with men attending. And it appears that that virus started to take hold through these two large events and then seeded outbreaks globally. We now, as Thomas has just mentioned, are seeing cases expanding rapidly and globally. I believe that at present, we are at, I think that Thomas, you actually summarized where we are in terms of the number of cases. As of today, we know that there are 66 countries with either confirmed or suspected cases, with 53 confirming transmission. And overall, there are approximately 5,000 confirmed and around 50 suspected cases, somewhere in that ballpark. We know this based on what we know from testing. Testing is limited. Testing is really only available in small, in not to all of the groups that need it. So we can assume that this outbreak is much larger than anticipated. And we're only talking about what's going on in countries outside of endemic Africa. Endemic Africa does not have the resources to do the kind of testing that is required. But even without that, we do know that cases have expanded exponentially over the last several years. So what we know about monkeypox in conclusion is what we know about monkeypox is mostly from studies early on with the epidemiologic and ecologic landscape very, very different. We are just beginning to understand what's happening. We probably have been seeing cases over many years increasing, but have not been going underdiagnosed. We will probably find that there is a lot more spread in the United States and elsewhere that we know about, but that we'll also learn that this is the case in Africa, because if you're not looking for it, you're not going to find that. You're not going to find it. And that is really where we stand today. Thomas, have I hit all of the key points to launch this discussion?
You've done a brilliant job. I'm going to ask with Lou's hopeful forgiveness, I'm going to ask you two very quick follow-ups just to set up Lou, before we get to her. The first is, right now there's been one confirmed death in Nigeria. We, of course, have a general audience today. Help them understand why, particularly when we've been talking about the COVID pandemic, where estimates of 15 to 18 million deaths, depending on the sources used, why should people care about the expanding monkeypox outbreak, given the lesser death toll? So that's the first question. And the second one I wanted to ask you is, what do we know about why imported cases or spread have burned out in the past? What has led to that? Close contact, of course, happens for many reasons. Why haven't we seen more sustained transmission in the past? What has led to that burning out?
Okay. So the first question is, why should we care about monkeypox? And that's a really good question. I think that there are some acute reasons to worry about monkeypox and some bigger kind of existential reasons that we have to worry about monkeypox. So the more near term is just that when you see a virus doing something that it doesn't normally do, you start to be concerned about it. What's happening? Is it changing? Is it becoming more transmissible? Is it just infecting a population that's vulnerable and doing what it would have done in any other situation where it has the runway to go, where it's never had before? We don't know the answer to that. And so we always have to treat that very carefully when we see something change in terms of cases. The bigger and more existential question about monkeypox kind of ties in here. We worry about monkeypox because we don't want to see morbidity or mortality from any virus that where we in particular can control it. But because monkeypox as a pox virus is something that we're very concerned about because we are losing immunity daily. As every day goes by, we have fewer and fewer people that have immunity to pox viruses from previous vaccination or infection in some cases. If we give this virus runway, we could see it mutate and evolve over time, become more fit, become more capable of transmitting from person to person. And that's concerning. As we know, pox viruses can cause severe disease. We're not seeing high rates of mortality right now, but we do know that this virus, when in its endemic regions, does cause severe disease and death. Rates range between 3 to 6% for the West African variant, and up to 10% for the Congo Basin clade. So that's concerning that we could see something happen, in particular in vulnerable, immunocompromised individuals and children. We could see this happen. Our other big concern is if we let this run in human populations, we could see it establish itself in animal reservoirs. And I am particularly concerned about reverse spillback. I feel when we talk about what happened in 2003 with the monkeypox outbreak that started in Gambian rats that were imported, transmitted to prairie dogs that were pets, we were lucky that we didn't see it go any further. We know that this virus has the ability to infect many species, in particular rodent species. And so as we see this continue to expand in human populations, the probability of a spillback event becomes larger and larger and more realistic. If this virus does establish itself in rodent populations in the United States, then we're going to have a virus that we're going to have to contend with. Not only are we going to have to worry about it in terms of risk to human populations, determining what it is we're willing to tolerate in terms of monkeypox, or in terms of a pox virus circulating, but then again, more opportunity for evolution with crossing back and forth between animals and humans. And I would say, we used to think about this as more theoretical, but we have very concrete examples from COVID-19 with SARS-CoV-2 of spillback into mink farms and then onward transmission. We've now just seen a documented case of a cat infecting a veterinarian. We know that it's now established itself in white-tailed deer. So, I think that some of these things that we used to talk about as theoretical issues are very real. And so I think that for these reasons, we worry about monkeypox. And so we have to determine how much in the short term, how quickly we can get our arms around this to avoid some of these much bigger issues. And I always like to say this falls into the category of my late father-in-law used to say, it's much easier to stay out of trouble than it is to get out of trouble. And I think that is very much the case here.
Great. Just quickly on the getting out of trouble part of the question, what do we know in brief about why outbreaks or importation of cases haven't sustained transmission in the past? Well, how does this normally burn out?
The thing is that, I think that we haven't seen these kind of intense social and sexual networks providing a runway for this before. So I think that monkeypox isn't as easily transmissible from person to person as something like SARS-CoV-2, which is just, we talk about that a lot, not because there's a good comparison there, but just because that's the context that we think about quite a bit. It is more difficult to transmit, but when you're talking about a lot of sexual contact with a lot of individuals, we really are giving this virus runway that it just hasn't had. We don't see that kind of contact in rural African villages to that extent. And that's really where it spread mostly previously. We have seen an uptick in the number of person-to-person transmissions. And I believe that there's going to be some data coming out that even in the West African context that shows maybe in prison settings or other congregate settings, you can see more transmission. So it makes sense when you have networks that you have so much contact, so many contact. We really are just, the virus is in a, circulating in a population that's giving it runway where it just didn't have it before. Will we see it burn out? We don't know, but we don't, we really have no context for this. So the question is at this point, how can we stop it so we don't see how far it can go? We prefer not to see that.
Great. That's a perfect segue, of course, to Lou, as Professor Rimoin was just explaining beautifully. This is a very different virus than SARS-CoV-2. That may be many people's frame of reference. One way in which, of course, it is different is that there are tools to address it. It's a older virus, and there have been investments. Tell us a bit about those tools, the vaccines, therapeutics, and diagnostics, and what potential they offer here.
Well, it's great to be here with you. So thanks for the invitation. Tom, you know that I began my career with D.A. Henderson at Hopkins, who was a giant in public health and led the smallpox eradication program. And I often catch myself these days thinking about DA and wondering, what would he be thinking about this moment in time? And I think that he'll be lamenting a lot of the current status and our earliest steps to counter it. But I'll focus my remarks on the countermeasures of vaccines, drugs, and diagnostic tests. And I think part of, the assessment has to do with whether you are a glass half full or a glass half empty kind of person. And I tend to be an optimist, but I am not as optimistic about the situation as normally I am, and I'll tell you why. So, we do have countermeasures. They're effective vaccines and even drugs that have activity against monkeypox. And it's also a disease, like Anne explained, that tends to spread slowly. And in settings of close or intimate contact. And so far, we haven't seen any deaths associated with the outbreaks in non-endemic areas. So that's the good news. The bad news, I think, is that the drugs and vaccines that are available have limitations or are available in just very limited supply. The best and most useful product in this situation is a vaccine made by Bavarian Nordic named Jynneos, which again is available in very limited supply. And this outbreak is occurring in a situation where the public and the medical and public health systems is very fatigued. Everybody's very fatigued. So I think that the idea of having to cope with yet another epidemic has been demoralizing, but it doesn't wait for us to, we just need to deal with it, right? So, and we cannot be complacent. And I think there's been a great deal of complacency since the first cases were detected in the US around May. I'm very encouraged that the administration announcement yesterday, that they announced yesterday renewed efforts, but I don't think they'll be sufficient. And from especially early on, there's been a lot of happy talk and focus on countermeasures, which is very normal and natural. Every time we see an emergent infectious disease, people say, how can I treat it? And they forget that, it's about how to use them, access to them, and a working public health system at all levels to make sure that we can effectively deploy these countermeasures, and that alone by themselves, they don't really contain an outbreak. So more specifically, there are two vaccines available. One is the ACAM2000, which is made by Emergent BioSolutions. It's based on the traditional smallpox vaccine. We began to develop that back in right after 9/11 in preparation for our biodefense program, out of concerns for a deliberate attack involving smallpox. And it's a very effective vaccine, has a lot of experience with its predicate vaccine over the years. It was used in the smallpox eradication program, but it can cause serious adverse effects, especially in individuals that have immunocompromising conditions or things like atopic dermatitis. It's also associated with myocarditis, about 5.7 per 1,000 primary vaccinees. It's even higher than the mRNA vaccines that we're dealing with right now for COVID. And sometimes even more serious adverse events, although they're rare. There is a protocol being established now for its use in monkeypox, but it's the kind of vaccine that I think people, if given a choice, would rather go with the safer vaccine, which is the one made by Bavarian Nordic. It's worth noting that we're supposed to have a dose for every American. This was established back in 2002, yet we have not kept our own commitment to ourselves and the government, and we only have about 100 million doses available in the stockpile. And, you know, and these require ancillary products to be administered, including needles and syringes and needles, special needles and diluents. And I'm not even sure that we have those in sufficient supply.
And just to be clear, when you say 100 million, you're referring to the emergent vaccine.
Yes, I'm still talking about that one. And we don't have information about the quality of these vaccines either, because, you know, we know that they were transferred from Sanofi to Emergent, and we, you know, it's no secret that Emergent had some struggles in manufacturing the COVID vaccines. So I'd like to see some reassurance. I'd like to have some reassurance, you know, that the stockpiled vaccines meets our quality standards, which we don't have today. The Bavarian Nordic vaccine, the one that is being deployed now, is also a live vaccine, attenuated vaccine, but it doesn't replicate. So it's safer and it elicits a very potent immune response. It's two doses, 28 days apart, but we know that the antibody response is the immune response happens after one dose. We don't know for sure that it works, you know, with one dose is sufficient to kind of dampen the epidemic if given post-exposure, but we think that there's a good chance it will. And it's been, it's licensed for smallpox and monkeypox. And it's been recommended for use actually since 2021 for at-risk individuals, those that have occupational lab exposures, for example, as a pre-exposure vaccine. And the administration is gonna release the vaccine to states. The strategy that is most efficient usually has to do with contact tracing, where they can really focus on contacts of individuals that have the infection. But in this instance, you know, it's been very challenging to trace sexual contacts. A lot of the early exposures have occurred in sex parties, where sometimes an individual has multiple partners and sometimes they're anonymous. So they can't really easily, you know, trace those contacts. So the strategy now is to deploy this limited supply of vaccine to areas of highest transmission based on current and projected population, adjusted incident cases. And they're gonna also look for weighted by population that has higher numbers of men that have sex with men, especially with HIV or who already take some HIV medications, just to be able to really focus on the most vulnerable. But the supply, I can't overstate how limited the supply is. I mean, yesterday the announcement talks about 1.67 million by the end of 2022. And as far as I know, we don't have any plans to expand domestic manufacturing capacity for this vaccine, which is still made in Denmark. And I think we need to kind of get on top of that. The WHO asked for countries to pull these vaccines, and there are no plans for people to do that until they meet their needs, I would say. For drugs, very briefly, there's a few countermeasures, but two antiviral drugs. TPOXX is very active against pox virus, a safe drug. It has been used to treat patients with a complication of smallpox vaccine called disseminated vaccinia. The major limitation of this drug is that it has a very low barrier to resistance. So it's not that hard for the virus to become resistant, sometimes during treatment with this drug. And that makes me really worried that if we begin to use it too broadly for a disease that at the end of the day is not severe for most people, that we can lose this valuable drug for treatment of people that have serious infection or even an eventuality of a smallpox event. But it is the best drug. The other drug, I'll be very direct, it's called Tembexa. It's been approved by the FDA. It's a very toxic drug. In my opinion, the FDA should not have approved that drug, especially with that input from its advisory committee. It was approved under the animal rule using only small animals and against orthopox viruses, but not monkeypox. And it carries a black box warning. Particularly because it showed some significant toxicity, including increased mortality, in clinical trials where it was deployed to treat other types of viruses. So it's not a really safe drug. And in the UK, they they have given it to a few patients with monkeypox, but they had to discontinue it because of liver toxicity. So, you know, I think that it's a fallacy to think that given a toxic drug is justified for some with a serious illness. I actually think that given a toxic drug for somebody who's really sick can make matters worse. And I would be very cautious about its use, but it's approved and the CDC is developing an expanded access protocol that would allow its use for treatment if needed. And then of course, I think that the best news is that we're now expanding diagnostic testing. I think it's been the right thing to do for the CDC to work with not only the laboratory response network, but also the commercial labs. Convenience to testing is very important if we're going to be able to diagnose individuals that are showing up for medical care. And actually, I would say that we need to make it permanent that our commercial labs across the nation should be part of our laboratory response network. We should have a much larger aperture beyond just public health labs. And you know, at the end of the day, I don't know if the glass is half full or empty for you. I think that we have we still have room to take a more aggressive and a certain stance to be able to combat. I don't think we're there yet. I'm encouraged by the recent actions that were announced yesterday.
Great, thank you. Thank you, Lou. I feel, I don't know about you, I feel I am dispositionally a half full person, but professionally a half empty person in terms of how I think about the world. But be that as it may. Two questions to follow up, and I recognize that we are heading up to the 20-minute mark. The first is, given what you've outlined about the limited supplies of our best vaccine option and its limitations, what is the public health strategy at this point for using that? Either in the US or globally, really? What allocation makes sense at this point? Is stopping transmission, breaking transmission chains really a realistic goal at this point, given we have 550 cases? I forget how many US states in how many US states, but many of them are not known contacts of one another. How should we be using these limited supplies? And then the second question, which is more of a point of information, but one that you might be able to give more insight. There has been some criticism of your former agency because the argument is that the US supplies of that vaccine are stuck in Denmark because FDA hasn't completed its inspection of the manufacturing facility. And of course, this outbreak has been going on for some time now. Tell us what you know about that or how that normally gets worked out and whether that's likely to be a more extended problem or just a very short-term hurdle.
Sure. So first, we have to try to break the chains of transmission. I think Anne would agree. You know, we don't want this to become entrenched and all the issues that she discussed in her comments. And this is a disease that, historically outbreaks have been contained because less transmissible it is. And it's right now we're seeing this because it's been in these networks, these sexual networks. It's not going to stay there if we don't act, but there's time to act. And we have to remember that we do have more vaccine. We have the optimal choice, but we have another vaccine that we need to make sure that we don't undermine because we may need to use it to be able to break these chains of transmission. It's a vaccine that has been used time and time again for eradication of smallpox, and we have to be able to find an efficient way to deploy it safely. And it's possible that, I'd rather have the drugs, for example, used to treat complications of the vaccination than to use a limited supply of drugs to treat a disease for which people tend to recover fairly, readily after, not a comfortable illness by any means, but the mortality, again, we haven't seen any deaths in the West. So I think we have to be very strategic about how we deploy that. We don't even know that the drugs work very well from monkeypox. There is a study that the NIH is going to launch next year in the DRC to evaluate it in the real, you know, real setting. So yes, I mean, yes, we have to do, much more. And I think we need to expand, you know, that diagnostics, which we will. You know, we are in a little bit of a strange situation where the numbers are going to go up a lot because now we're finding the cases. It doesn't mean that the outbreak is necessarily expanding, but it may seem that way. So we just have to be able to interpret the data and kind of figure this out. It's not clear exactly what, you know, the interpretation of the data is going to be a little challenging, but we have to keep that in mind. It doesn't mean that we should just give up and say this is out of control and then and not do the efforts. I think that, you know, this issue with the FDA, look, it's such an easy agency to criticize. And I just, you know, in my own remarks, criticized the licensure of a very toxic drug without input from the advisory committee. I think that when it comes to inspections of facilities, you know, we want to make sure the product is, it's a product that, you know, it's a sterile product to be given to people. We want to make sure that it meets quality standards. Nobody wants to receive a product that was not inspected by the FDA. So what they can do is they can accelerate the inspection process. They can reprioritize the inspection process. So I'm sure that that's underway now, but it's not going to change materially, you know, like the numbers that we'll have because there's finite manufacturing capacity in Denmark for this vaccine. And we really need to think in the long run that we need a much, much larger and sustained ability to manufacture the vaccine. And I would say that we, you know, given what we learned over the last few years, you know, it's important that we focus domestically. We have the capacity domestically to manufacture this vaccine, and we need to work with the company to be able to expand it domestically.
Great. I have loads more questions, but we have limited time, so I will not try the patience of the audience any further. Most of you have done this many times before. Please, let me let the operator explain. Operator, will you let them know how to ask questions?
As a reminder, to ask a question, please click on the raise hand icon on your Zoom window. When you are called on, please accept the unmute now prompt, then proceed with your name and affiliation, followed by your question. If you would like to view the roster of registered participants for this meeting, please click the link in the Zoom chat.
Great. Well, I see Sonia has been waiting for a very long time to ask her question. So why don't we start with you, Sonia?
Thanks so much, Tom. And thanks to Lou and Anne for this excellent discussion. Sonia Stokes, Mount Sinai Eckhart School of Medicine. So my question is about the case criteria, because many healthcare workers, myself included, are in a catch-22 with the current case criteria and its practical applications. We know many cases are presenting atypical to the characteristic rash, including patients I have had myself. However, unless patients have that characteristic rash or meet certain narrow epidemiologic parameters, mainly travel risks or intimate contact in certain social networks, it is very difficult to obtain testing, even in New York City. This is severely hampering our surveillance capabilities, especially in high-risk populations, such as an example, our pediatric patients. Is the primary reason for limiting the case criteria at this point in the outbreak due to our limited testing capacity? And if so, what else can be done to mitigate spread, break those chains of transmission with this major barrier to surveillance, as well as in that setting of insufficient accessible pharmaceutical interventions? Thank you.
Great. Lou, I see you took yourself off mute, so maybe you want to start, and then Anne, I would love to hear your thoughts on testing too.
Hi, Sonia. And I just for the record, I did not take myself off mute, but
I'm sorry.
you know, I think that there's many issues that sometimes impede testing early on, and we know that limited supply is one of them. I don't think this is going to be the case here. You know, this is a PCR test, and as soon as you get you know, the kits validated, you should be able to scale pretty quickly. I think there's also this conservative idea early on that we haven't learned our lesson, but the idea that if you begin to test people that are not part of that at-risk population, that we're going to end up with false positives, and we are kind of averse to that idea. But then we don't actually find the cases that we need to, and we underestimate the numbers. So I think that we need to learn also as a lesson that for new emerging diseases, we need to be more aggressive and accept the fact that we may end up with some false positives early on.
So I'll take myself off mute on purpose here. And I agree with Lou's comments here. You know, it's complicated just due to the lack of diagnostics, but I think that that's going to change fairly rapidly. And you know, I think that as in all things, if there's no capacity, it doesn't matter if you expand the criteria, we're not going to be able to test those people. But as we are only able to test people that are meeting a very narrow criteria, we're certainly not going to know what the true burden of disease is. So I think that this will change rapidly in the coming weeks, but it doesn't solve the problem in the short term. And in the short term is it anybody who thinks that they have a characteristic rash or even an exposure or some reason to believe that they have monkeypox should consult with their clinician, and their clinician should have a high index of clinical suspicion depending upon what the patient history is.
Great. Thank you both. It is concerning, of course, that we are at this point 10 weeks into this and to have the same testing problems as we had the last time, particularly for a disease we are trying to contain or obviously eliminate from non-endemic settings at a minimum, in addition to what we want to do in endemic settings. I am very pleased to welcome next in the queue my former colleague, Lori Garrett. Love to hear her question. Before she asks it, just to let everyone else in the audience know, please do raise your hand. We have space in the queue after Lori, so we'd love to hear from Lori now.
Hi, I have a broken microphone. Are you here?
Yeah. We're mostly hearing you.
Good old Yeti microphones. Quick question.
Lori, we stopped hearing you.
Me now.
You are still breaking up. Lori, what I'm happy to do, if you have a short way of asking, if you want to email it to me, I'll read it out for you and ask the people that way. Otherwise, I'm not sure what the best way, or you can put it in the chat if that's possible.
Or you can even call me and put it, or call one of us and we can just put the phone on speaker.
All right. Well, while we sort that out with Lori, we have a next question in the queue from Gabrielle Fitzgerald.
Hi, Tom. Hi, everyone. Thanks for this really informative session today. My question is, you've primarily talked about the US response. How would you characterize other countries' responses? Are there any models that we should be looking to?
Well, I can just start briefly here and say that the UK has been very aggressive in terms of trying to roll out as much testing as possible and making vaccination available. Same with Canada, has done a good job of being able to do so. But of course, everything is just limited by diagnostics, by the sheer numbers, and that is diagnostics available and treatment available or vaccines available. You know, what I would also say is I think at our own peril, when we're talking about this in a broader sense, we're always focusing on what's going on in the West, whereas in DRC and other countries in Africa, you know, we've been battling monkeypox outbreaks for an extended period of time. And I think it's going to be important ethically and also just in terms of global health equity that we not forget that we have, you know, as many cases just in DRC potentially that are going undiagnosed as there are globally. And so if we don't deal with the equity issue and the issue of managing outbreaks at their source, we are constantly going to be chasing behind this.
Lou, anything to add?
No, I agree. And you know, this conversation just reminded me that, you know, remember that during the Ebola epidemic in West Africa, you know, the real kind of red flag went off when the case was imported to Nigeria. And Nigeria is seen as this, you know, the country that is the most populous country in Africa and with direct flights to many places around the world. And, you know, we should have known that this was gonna happen when you look back. And, you know, there was a few cases that were happening in Nigeria recent, like in a couple of, I think back in 2 years or so. And I am just, you know, again, it's in hindsight, but we're asleep at the wheel. And I credit Tom Frieden, the Council on Foreign Relations Fellow as well, and a senior fellow, that, you know, for making the case of Nigeria and making the, and sounding the alarm so that we could act around that to counter the Ebola, because he really was able to foresee the danger that expansion into Nigeria posed. But Anne is absolutely correct that we need to focus in the endemic countries as well. And sadly, I don't see any signs that we'll be doing that until, you know, this new era of meet the domestic needs first.
I just want to expand upon what you're saying briefly, because this is one of the things that I've been thinking quite a bit about. You know, I mean, in terms of foreseeing this, you know, we've all, any of us who have been working on pox viruses have foreseen this over a long period of time. And these were I was at Hopkins with DA, was mentored by DA as well. And I often think about what he would think about this. And the last paper that he reviewed for me was a paper that I wrote in 2010 about in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, describing this large increase in monkeypox over time. And one of the things that we discussed at great length was the issue of what could potentially happen. We could see this, you know, more human-to-human transmission. We could see potential evolution in fitness. We could see potential reverse zoonotic spillover. But we also very clearly spelled out the potential for exportation and what that would start to look like. So I think all of these, you know, everything that we're seeing was foreseeable and predictable. I think just, you know, nobody had really thought about what happens if it's got into very, very intensive sexual and social networks and to see this happen in this way. What I will also say though, is that this really does mirror the West African outbreak in so many ways. I mean, if you think about the trajectory of what we saw with Ebola, that it was first discovered in 1976 in DRC and then in Sudan. We saw it kind of, you know, sputtering around Central Africa for several decades. Then all of a sudden we saw this emerge in Guinea in this outbreak, and it was smoldering. It was probably transmitting for an extended period of time, but nobody knew because nobody was looking for it. And it was only once it had exploded in West Africa and was already, you know, a fire out of control that we even noted it. And only when it then became an issue in Nigeria and where we could see that we just, you know, barely averted a bigger issue, and then the importation of cases or having Westerners get infected, that I think the world really paid attention. You know, similarly with monkeypox discovered in 1970, smoldering around, you know, seeing cases occurring sporadically in West or in Central Africa. You know, clearly there's some sort of host a range shift that we may have seen, that we started to see more cases. And we saw this occurring in Nigeria. And then the exportation of cases, because Nigeria is an economic and hub for the world. So I think that these patterns are important. I think that the similarities between these two need to be noted. And, you know, should we dare to make these same mistakes again? It's truly at our own peril. I will also say monkeypox has been something, in terms of emerging infections, is something that's very visible for people, because there is a rash associated. And I would say, you know, if this is something that we can see, I worry about what we're not seeing transmitting in these contexts in terms of emerging disease. And with the world as connected as we are. So I just want to underscore that, you know, the importance of that. The last thing I want to bring up is just when I said this about, well, you know, monkeypox is so visible, you know, I would posit that this issue of transmission that we're seeing, you know, potentially, you know, focused rashes, much, you know, atypical presentations, You know, I would say that in DRC, for example, we haven't been looking for that. How do we know that that hasn't been happening over time or anywhere else for that matter? I think that, we need to be very humble about what we know and about what we don't know and recognize that, you know, we have a shifting epidemiologic and, ecologic landscape and that we need to really reevaluate what we think we know going forward.
Great. Lori, we have managed to work this out, has emailed me her question. I do not promise to deliver it with the same verve as she might have, but I will read it. And after that, I will take Mitchell's question, and then we'll close up with the answers from both of our panelists. So Lori writes, CDC tells me that they do not have a blood test and have not screened even cohort samples of US blood banks. This is reminiscent of HIV in 1981, 82. Why is testing donated blood not currently not possible? Should this be a high priority? Is any country doing it? And let me take Mitchell's question as well, and then you can answer both of them.
Great, Tom, thank you so much. And thank both of you for great presentations and overviews. I'll be quick. It goes back to, Tom, where you started. Just last week, WHO's International Health Regulations Emergency Committee is seeing this as a public health emergency of international concern. And I would just love to hear both of you opine a bit about what that means, both for the current situation, but also given the last 2.5 years, how we think about the international health regulations, and are we missing an opportunity right now?
Thank you, Mitchell. You have made that easy for me because Anna is actually a member of that committee, so has said prior to this, which I should have pointed out, that she is not prepared to answer questions about the committee, particularly since it may be reconvened. So I'm going to throw the international health regulations question to Lou for 1 minute on that. And then perhaps Anne would be willing to take Lori's questions about blood banks.
So, and I'll touch base on that too, and she may correct me on the blood bank. You know, just have to, for clarification, that the diagnosis of monkeypox is through PCR of the swab lesions, because by the time the lesions appear, it's thought that the there's no more virus in the blood. So I think what Larry's talking about is really the antibody surveillance to find out, you know, if people have been infected and recovered, and, you know, how prevalent was this in the population, and is there silent transmission that we're not seeing? And it's very easy to do serial surveys and blood bank to have a sense of that. There are plans by the administration, OSDP and NIH and CDC and others to begin to look at that as a research question. I don't know really. I'm at a loss sometimes about the WHO assessment of the committee. So Anna's the expert and she can comment. I think that, I'm truly at a loss, Tom. I mean, I think I wish that they had made a recommendation, because clearly this is a global epidemic, and we need to be able to focus our resources on it. And I think that by not declaring it, it may slow things down. But I don't know exactly what went through, you know, and how the discussions were held.
Great. And we have 1 minute. So blood banks.
Okay. So blood banks. I actually, Lori, that's an excellent question. And that's something that I have been thinking about myself in terms of how we can look for this. But, you know, the truth is that there are no good serologic assays for monkeypox either. And this is something that's hindered my own research. I've been looking for a good assay for a very long time, and it just doesn't exist. I think that that's something that hopefully will be developed quickly and something that should be ascertained. And certainly we should be screening for that, among other things as well. The last thing I will say just about the public health emergency of international concern, I can say just, you know, I mean, one thing that I do have to say about it is something that I think that the director general said, which is, I think that the way that the system is set up is not exactly optimal for being able to describe what is happening in any circumstance, the binary yes or no about whether or not this constitutes an emergency makes it very complicated. And I would suggest, as Dr. Tedros has suggested, that there should be more of a stoplight scenario where it is graded And the, just as in all things, it's not yes or no. You could have a green, yellow, and red warning system. And I hope that there will be some sort of reform in that regard, so that there is, that the subtleties of this can be better better assessed in future.
Great. Well, we will have to debate reforms to the IHR in another CFR session. I want to thank both of our speakers for their excellent remarks today, all of you for joining us. I also want to thank my RA, Sam Kiernan, for organizing this event and for all that she has done at the council. This is her second to last day. And also Bloomberg Philanthropies for their generous support of this roundtable series. Thanks so much. I look forward to seeing you next time.
Thank you.
Thanks for having me.